A very warm welcome on what is a reasonably chilly evening. So thank you very much for making the journey tonight. For those of you who don't know, Garratt Publishing's been in existence for more than 20 years. So we are totally independent publisher of Catholic and Christian materials. We believe that what the work that we do provides a platform for people to share and express their thoughts around their faith. Hopefully, their spiritual journey and well-being is supported by the books that we do. Tonight, I have the great pleasure of, with readings, introducing to the world David Tacey's new book. But before that, and without too much further ado, I'd like to introduce to you our new publisher, well, newish. Regina Lane started with Garratt back in October, I think. I might have got that wrong, but it seems about October was the right time. And she's a very acclaimed author in her own right. If anybody saw Eureka Street today, we were well supported. David's title was there, as well as Regina was interviewed about her life and her journey to Garratt Publishing. And she's going to just tell you a little bit about that and how we came about to bring David's book to the Australian public. So without further ado, I'll hand you over to Regina.
It's a real pleasure to be here as the publisher of David Tacey's new book. I started reading the works of David Tacey about 10 years ago. I was working at that time for the Brigidine sisters, who thankfully bought books like David's and encouraged me to read them. Like many people in this audience, I grew up in the straitjacket, perhaps, of a fairly conservative Catholic church. And for all its virtues, it was a place where I often learnt to see things in quite black and white terms. As such, it was with a great relief in my early 20s to discover, well, a whole raft of books, thanks to the Brigidines, but one author in particular, which was David Tacey, and to read his work and realise that my faith was not weak for questioning and asking and doubting and even disbelieving. In fact, I had begun what David calls in this book a crucial stage of the faith journey, the stage of waking up, where one begins to take personal responsibility for their own spirituality, that the kingdom of God isn't something that happens, you know, up there or in another millennium. It's happening inside all of us. So that was the gift of David Tacey's writing on me as a young, quite cynical Catholic. Fast forward 10 years, and I was then in a conversation about taking up a position at Garratt Publishing. And having just spent a decade working as a social activist, where, among other things, I played a role in a battle against the Catholic Church to save my own church, St. Bridget's, which I've written about in detail, a story that became less a battle about saving a property and more a battle about saving the soul of a community. As such, it was a little unsure about taking up a job as a Catholic publisher, and I was worried that I might be forced back into some kind of straitjacket that I sometimes remember from my childhood, a place where asking big questions, where doubting, where questioning and even disbelieving might not be the done thing. But then I learned that I would be publishing a book by David Tacey, a book called Beyond Literal Belief, a book that, in the face of widespread atheism and increasing fundamentalism, seeks to win what I think is perhaps a much larger battle, and that effectively is the battle for truth, the kind of truth that, as David says, is one we can only really find deep inside. And it is a battle. We're living in a very crazy, fast-paced, consumerist and increasingly atheist world. And so to attempt to reconnect us with the essence or the soul of our Christian story is an entirely ambitious undertaking, but that's exactly what David has done, has achieved in this book. And so it was with this book in my hands that I made up my mind, a Catholic publisher I would become. And so tonight I am proud to be publishing a book by an author who has fundamentally changed my own thinking and helped renew my own faith, but also proud to be publishing that book on behalf of Garratt Publishing, a Catholic publishing house that is not afraid to ask the hard questions. And so I'd like to welcome to you David Tacey, Emeritus Professor of Humanities at La Trobe University, Melbourne. David is an interdisciplinary scholar and public intellectual who has written extensively on spirituality, religion, youth experience and mental health. He's the author of 14 books. I'm sure many of you are well aware of these. Edge of the Sacred, Reenchantment, The New Australian Spirituality and The Spirituality Revolution. When I asked David last year who might he like to launch his book, he said he couldn't think of a better placed person than Rachael Kohn, who, as we all know, as the broadcaster from ABC for some 20 years, I think, Rachael, who is most notably known as the presenter of the Spirit of Things program on a Sunday night. Rachael is also an author in her own right, and given that her first book was called The New Believers, Reimagining God, I think we're in for quite an interesting evening tonight. Welcome, Rachael.
Well, it's lovely to be here, and it's a great testimony to the fact that religious faith, spirituality is alive and well in the suburbs of all the big cities and the small ones. Well, sometimes I feel like I'm stuck in the middle of T.S. Eliot's wasteland, where the second stanza speaks to me of our world. What are the roots that clutch? What branches grow out of this stony rubbish? Son of man, you cannot say or guess, for you know only a heap of broken images where the sun beats. Now it is the vain courage of the foolish that compels me to begin this launch with an excerpt from one of the greatest poems in the English language, certainly in the 20th century, which I have not studied, nor have I the literary skill and expertise that David Tacey has, whose book I'm launching tonight. Yet, right or wrong, Eliot's lines make me think of how much the seeds of faith seem to languish on the stony, unyielding ground of our contemporary worldview, which appears not to have deepened its appreciation of the inherited biblical tradition, but has left it behind to molder, like some artifacts dug up on an archaeological dig and forgotten. In faith's stead, a host of other trendy interests have beckoned: exotic gods, esoteric practices, manga comics, and gothic internet games. But the Son of Man arouses fewer responses, except from the so-called educated, who, armed with a smattering of science and history, have deemed him a hopelessly irrelevant figure of a bygone age. But this kind of education, which has foregrounded scientific understanding and neo-Marxist and materialism, has stifled our understanding of something that lives and speaks beyond or deep within the material world. And it is David Tacey's explorations over a lifetime and a large number of books that have tapped into this deeply human, not merely humanistic, dimension of understanding. What is this dimension but the mythopoetical part of our imaginal capacity that can be animated and inspired by the Son of Man, or indeed any significant religious figure like Abraham, Moses, King David, or the Buddha? And it is this mythopoetic understanding of the scriptures that can provide a lifeline to faith. But as David Tacey has argued in this book, which at times has the full force of a polemic, it's a kind of faith that is at odds with the Christian religion as it has been articulated by the church councils beginning in the 4th century and defended by the church ever since. He regards the council's quote-unquote absurdities to be a parody of faith from which the true faith needs to be recovered. Well aware that he will be regarded as heretical, David presses on with an understanding of faith that owes a great deal to the depth psychologist Carl Jung, who's also regarded as heretical by the Catholic Church, despite his popularity among many Catholics today. The charge of heresy has often been applied to deeply insightful figures like the 13th century Dominican priest Meister Eckhart, and, not least, to Jesus himself. But I hasten to add that I'm not making comparisons between Tacey, Jung, and Jesus in an attempt to deflate the importance of the one who's believed to be God, nor to elevate Jung to the level of Tacey. Most of David's work is well known to me, since he has been a guest on The Spirit of Things at least 6 times, discussing spiritual sickness, re-enchantment, men, the New Age, and Jung, and even willingly assuming the mantle of a grumpy old man, bleating about people who diss religion. I've read most of his books, and in this one, Beyond Literal Belief, I see that he has finally uncovered fully the foundation on which he has stood for a long time. It's as if all his early hunches from a remarkably thoughtful youth through to the accumulated insights from his adult reading life have congealed into a block, some might say a soapbox, on which he now comfortably stands to deliver his hammer blows of critique on the one hand, and his new religion on the other. Forgive me if this sounds cultish. It isn't, but I couldn't think of another term to use, although it is in fact an old religion, if David's argument is to be accepted. In a nutshell, he's offering a faith which accepts the scriptures as holy, but not historical. They are to be read for their mythological meaning, not to be taken as literal truth in the way one scours a ship's logbook for vital facts of a voyage. On the contrary, the voyage taken on this ship of faith is one that depends on the ability of the reader to reflect on the details of the story with the help of a person trained in the reading of myth as symbolic of psychic transformation, the spiritual transformation of one's psyche or soul, to use the Greek terminology. A great many of David's statements on religion can be read as grenades lobbed right into the middle of the establishment, like, the less we believe, the better. And we don't need miracles to be literally true. Once we understand their meaning, they have performed their function. Thus does he demolish the belief in the literal truth of miracles like the virgin birth or the bodily resurrection, or even Jesus turned into God. Instead, he finds that the meaning of these events is what is required of the reader. But of course, this process of deciphering may differ according to each reader. Not surprisingly, the kind of spirituality that David finds in the scriptures is not very concerned with ethics or moralism, which he finds a kind of reductionism of the scriptures to an anti-spiritual level. His is an intensely private and personal spirituality, which owes little to the laws that govern the community and more to the need to overcome the ego, which masks a deeper, more vulnerable self. Hence, David's Jesus is not calling for moral righteousness, but spiritual transformation. He says of Jesus that he is not calling for better behavior, but for initiation. Immediately, I recognize one of David's abiding concerns, which he wrote about in his previous book on spiritual diseases. That is, the need for men to undergo initiation rituals to induce a spiritual transformation that matures the soul. In many ways, this book speaks to a late modern age, which has already lost its nerve on most moral issues and can barely say the word righteousness without choking in embarrassment. But maybe this is exactly what Jesus himself felt 2,000 years ago when he challenged those who were without sin to cast the first stone. There are some strong words in this book with which I cannot agree, such as the charge that literalism leads to violence and metaphorical interpretations do not. Literalism can lead to violence, but in most cases it does not. Why? Because when reading scriptures, one always finds that there are countervailing passages which convey the exact opposite sentiment. And who can be so sure that interpreting scriptures as myths with manifold meanings does not result in a negative judgment of individuals or groups and a call for a genocidal program of elimination? It certainly did in the Nazi movement of the New Faith, a mixture of Eastern and pre-Christian and occult mythology, which resulted in a program of killing Jews, Gypsies, Slavs, and other unfortunate groups targeted for extinction. I know David would immediately say that this was the wrong reading, a reductionist reading of the myths in question, but it's governing that dynamic area between the myth and its interpretation, which has always been the preserve and responsibility of religion. And for better or worse, it has tried to prevent the slippage into a violent reading that results in wars or worse. We all come from our own experiences of faith, and I realize that my profession has made me unusually informed about contemporary religious thinking and spiritual movements today, and they make me less pessimistic than David about the state of Christian belief. Many of the evangelical Christians in the West today are nothing like the bigoted, narrow-minded, and judgmental believers that they are often caricatured to be by the liberal, secular, or liberal Christian left. This year, a gay Anglican in the high church tradition told me in a conversation about religion and humor that he is physically sickened by his colleagues who constantly tell jokes at the expense of the evangelical wing of the church as a way of confirming their own smug superiority. I heartily agreed and wondered when I would ever hear this kind of sentiment uttered again from his corner of the church in Sydney. He was a voice in the wilderness. I've also found that Christians who believe in the virgin birth, in Jesus as God, and in his physical resurrection are wonderful human beings with quite subtle interpretive capabilities and profoundly generous behavior, just as I have found Buddhists who accept reincarnation to be true, and Hasidic Jews who believe in the miraculous workings of their Rebbe to be extremely committed to working for the betterment of the world and in helping others in the most dire circumstances, or just in building bridges of interfaith friendship with even their most threatening enemies. I know that David is not a Cervantes tilting at windmills. His concerns are real ones. The possible death of faith in an overly rationalist, unforgiving world, where the Son of Man lies forgotten among broken remnants of the past, is a world where the human cost of that unknowing are societies of people without hope who often turn to a self-destructive nihilism. Finally, I'm particularly appreciative of a strain of thought in David's book which calls to account the biblical criticism that has enthusiastically revived our understanding of first century history, while forgetting one of the most animating features of the Jewish culture that formed the mind of Jesus and also the rabbis of his time, the world of Midrash, the license to retell the stories of the Bible in highly imaginative ways to deliver a timeless and perhaps a new message. That creative freedom is something that is all too often forgotten in an age where knowledge on the internet is free, but wisdom is indeed hard to find. And with this creative freedom, David Tacey has sought to melt down the dogmas and offer a way to the enchanted world that already exists to those who are spiritually free enough to enter it. Thank you, and I give you David Tacey for his remarks on his book.
Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight on this cold 10-degree day. I think it got down to 6 earlier. Well, that was very, very fascinating. We have a conversation later on scheduled, not tonight, but on radio, on Rachael's show, The Spirit of Things. This is a book I've wanted to write basically all my life, growing up as I did in a devoutly religious family. My family and its cultural network read scripture literally as fact, and we were uneducated and perhaps could be excused for this error. But what made matters worse was that the clergy in our world encouraged the literal reading and saw it actually as a sign of true faith. Ever since I was about 14 and began to question these assumptions, I had a sense that much of what we viewed as history was actually metaphor. Jesus' teachings were conveyed in parables, which are metaphors, and no one ever assumed that these parables were literally true. His own life, in turn, was narrated in parables, but for various reasons, many decided that they were literally true. Lots of people, even today, swear that every word of his life story is historical. To me, it was a tragedy that this, at the time, fledgling religion promoted as history because it called its integrity into question. People of other faith traditions saw through the lies immediately, but converts to Christianity boasted that all the parables were true and God himself had come down to earth. I've no doubt that Jesus existed as an actual figure, that he was a genuine prophet who tried to bring people closer to truth. But to me, the supernatural infrastructure of the story and all the miracles and wonders that were overlaid on his narrative were invented by writers. My view of Jesus has always been closer to, I think, the Jewish view than to the Christian. He was a prophet, but not God. And my family would not have coped with my point of view, so I kept quiet, and even today, dare not tell them, none of them are here, of course, what for them is history is for me myth. So this book is confessional in part, I think Rachael alluded to that, and it's what I would have said 50 years ago if I'd had the language to say it. People have said, just as well I live in Australia, because making these pronouncements in America might result in death threats, as for instance Bishop Spong has received and continues to receive on a regular basis. And I guess this is something to be thankful for. The only three things that excite Australians are Anzac Day, Budget Day, like yesterday, and football. And religion is not one of the nerve centres of the nation. And people don't care enough, actually, to get terribly excited. But my book isn't a demolition job. Earlier today, we had a music tutor coming over to teach Hayley how to play the piano, and he saw the copy of my book, and he said, "Oh, beauty, Richard Dawkins, Religion as Metaphor. Can I get a copy?" And I said, "Yes, of course, I'll sell you a copy." But what I didn't tell him was that it's not in the Richard Dawkins tradition. So I suspect that if this book does well, it might be because of a mistake. But I think I'm sort of following at the footsteps of Richard Dawkins. So I'm not really, like Dawkins, doing a demolition job on religion, unlike some other books that try to look at the religious life in terms of myth. I try to rescue truth from these metaphors. To me, the metaphors point to something, even though in themselves they're not literally true, in my view. As an American schoolboy once said to his teacher, a myth is something that's true on the inside, but not true on the outside. I found that really helpful, really, really helpful. And after mythic traditions are deconstructed, it would be foolish and insensitive, I think, not to see beyond the myths to the kernels of truth inside them. For instance, to give you some examples, feeding the 5,000 with a couple of loaves and fishes is hardly, to me, true on the outside, but the connotation might be true. That is, that people walked away from the teachings of Jesus feeling nourished by what they'd heard. Myths work on the as-if factor. It was as if they'd been given physical nourishment. And I think myths tend, on the whole, to tell spiritual tales using physical metaphors. The virgin birth, I have a lot to say about that in this book, is to me a myth with no historical content. But if we use our imaginations, we can rescue some of its meaning. It refers to the birth of the spiritual life in the soul. And this is not a sexual or biological process, but something that happens spontaneously by itself, as if in a miraculous manner, inverted commas. When I was doing my PhD at the University of Adelaide in the 1970s, I read a lot of ancient mythology and found there were hundreds upon hundreds of virgin births in antiquity. And I was sort of firstly quite unsettled by this. I thought there was only one virgin birth. But that's sort of what churches would have you believe. Clearly, this was an ancient literary trope, and even the Egyptian pharaohs claimed to have been born of virgins. The motif of a virgin birth was attributed, in fact, to anyone who was felt to have special gifts, but to take this literally is, to me, a failure to read myth correctly. And, of course, feminists have had a lot to say about that too, and the effect of the taking that literally have had on women's understandings of themselves and their sexuality has been catastrophic. So in that regard, I'd take issue with Rachel and say that I think that sometimes taking things literally can be socially catastrophic in their consequences. We could have a chat about this on radio. So watch the space. The physical resurrection is another of the wonders that many take literally, thus I think losing its meaning. It refers to the hope and expectation that the spirit lives on after death and does not negate the creativity that an individual life began. As St. Paul put it in 1 Corinthians, if we think of resurrection literally, we are being foolish. That's exactly what he said. Few, however, have heeded his warnings about the Easter story, except perhaps the Jesuits, who have never taken this literally, although people don't sort of realise how radical the Jesuits are. And if I'm heretical, Rachel, well then the Jesuits are doubly heretical, and yet they're, of course, an established order of the Catholic Church. So there's a lot... Catholic Church is a very big, baggy monster, you know. There's lots of things going on in it, and lots of people disagree with each other, but somehow or other they get on, just. So there are two acts of interpretation to perform: breaking the myth open and fossicking around for its inside meaning. I think just to break the myth open without offering anything in response is an act of cultural vandalism, and I think Rachel would agree with me on that. This is dangerous to tradition and has no redemptive value. While the first act looks like a Richard Dawkins act, looks like atheism, the second act is actually an act of reparation, of saying, okay, we can't accept the outside of this myth, but what's going on the inside, and what is it telling us? And that's what Rachel referred to as the mythopoetic dimension of religion. And I don't think any of us should give that away, because I think that has a saving grace. So my work is paradoxical. It both is deconstructive and reconstructive. And I think that to promote religion today, we first have to demote it, ironically, from its status as history. Now, the new atheists that I've already mentioned, the Richard Dawkins, Christopher Hitchens, and so on, do have something in common with my project, but they stop at the stage of destruction. They squash the myths, demolish a host of sort of an army of straw men and women, as it were, and they say, end of story, you know, this is all there is. But to me, the real adventure begins where Dawkins and Hitchens leave off. What is behind the myth? To what strange truth does it point? Why has this particular symbol been used so carefully by these writers of scripture? And the atheists seem to me get part of the way. We are clearly in an atheistic phase in Australia at the moment. They clear the decks, but they don't invite the inside meaning back. I'm not opposed to them, like many religious people are, but simply believe they actually don't go far enough. Of course the metaphors aren't scientifically valid, but they are philosophically and mythopoetically valid. So my book is not saying that the task of interpretation is something we perform on a text written by benighted minds who thought they were recording history. My argument is actually the opposite of this. I believe the scripture writers were fully cognizant of what they were doing, and they understood it as a literary convention of the time. If something was truly holy, it could only be narrated in myth, symbol, and metaphor, as history was considered too flat and banal to be able to actually tell sacred stories. And when I discovered this quote, which appears in the book by Dominic Cresson from Chicago, I think, he said, quote, "My point is not that those ancient people told literal stories and we are now smart enough to take them symbolically, but that they told them symbolically and we are now dumb enough to take them literally." So they knew what they were doing, we don't. And that was my eureka moment. As Rachael said, this is a book that I've been actually writing sort of indirectly all my life, at least since I was about 14. My daughter Anna, sitting down here on the floor, asked me the other day, "How long did it take you to write this, Dad?" And I was going to say, you know, 58 years or something. How long does it take to write a book? It just dates for ages. The book evolved over the course of decades. And, of course, as I said, it had its genesis in my adolescence. But since this is budget week and Joe Hockey's in the news, Joe Hockey actually recently wrote an article for the Sydney Morning Herald called God is Good But Don't Take Him Too Literally. And he, on the cover of it, he has God extending the breath of life to Adam, and Adam's going like this in a gesture of defiance, saying, "No, I don't want it." And Hockey, who I don't have much in common with, actually, says that the reason religion's in the mess it's in, and he's talking in particular about Catholicism, is because too much of it is read literally. He's a religious guy himself and is concerned about this problem. So it's not just me. I mean, you know, I haven't just invented this. The conundrum of religion and the crisis of faith is a literary problem. And as a professor of literature, I saw this challenge as too good to refuse. Belief has become shaky, but there is still, I think, an opportunity for faith if we read the metaphors correctly. Now, this has great implications for school teachers and everybody working in the field of education. How do we teach these stories to avoid the literal interpretation? Because if we do, then we can guarantee that by the time they get to about 8 or 9, they're saying, "I can't believe half of it, so why believe any of it?" And religious teachers throughout Australia and indeed the educated world are saying that the kids are just turned off in religious education classes because they see it as making a mockery of their intelligence. So with this book, I'm hoping to actually reignite religious education and to open it up to the imagination. And one of the things I find about Christian theologians, particularly in Australia, they don't have much to say about this topic. I mean, Rachael might correct me, but I think this is the only book that actually tackles literalism in the Christian religion. There might be some that I don't know, but a lot of Christian theologians are happy for myth to exist in the Jewish scriptures. So they're quite happy to say the crossing of the Red Sea is myth, or the Garden of Eden with the talking serpent and eating the apple and God walking with Adam and Eve in the cool of evening. They're always happy to say that's myth. But when it gets to the Gospels, no, there's no myth in there. That's all history because it's got to be dinky-dye. So there's a sort of a double standard here, and I don't like the way some Christian theologians are happy to talk mythically about Judaism and only literally and factually about their own sacred texts. So my book asks, what would religion look like if all that I've said tonight is taken into account? What would faith look like without the props of belief? And I make a big deal in this book of the difference between faith and belief, and I've become annoyed, actually, by the way these two terms, very different, are used now interchangeably. You find that if people talk about these things, faith and belief are synonymous. Now, they're very different. To me, faith is much more important than belief, because belief is often some sort of gullible agreement or a gullible acceptance, if you like, of impossible events. Now, finally, just some acknowledgements due, firstly, to my publisher, Regina Lane, who addressed us at the start, for her dedication to this project which has been flawless throughout. I'd like to thank Gary Eastman, who took this on in the first place and risked backing the book. I'm sure you now regret it, Gary, after what you've heard tonight about being a heretic, possibly burnt at the stake at midnight on Glenferrie Road, I don't know. And David Hewen here, thank you for handling the business matters, and Rose for your participation in this project. This book is also being published, and just as a nice little note and little omen today, in the mail came the US edition of the book. Don't buy it, because this is the one to buy and this is more expensive. But I thought I'd just wave it at you. This is being published in New Jersey and also in London, and I'm really pleased about that. Maybe I'll get death threats via email from the United States. I don't know what's going to happen. All I know is I really had to write this book, and I really think that, you know, what's in it is something that is valid for me, and I hope that for you it might be of some use as well. I'd like to thank my US publisher, Transaction Press, who aren't here, Jennifer Nippens, who actually, unbelievably, resigned as soon as this book came out. And I'm thinking, is that an omen as well? I don't know. But anyway, she'd had enough, and all I got from her was a resignation note. But she saw this book through its various stages of production. And someone unknown to me did a fine job of the index, and then the pages were actually sent to Garratt Publishing. I just want to tell you a little anecdote to finish. What really triggered this book, although I said to Arno I've been writing it all my life, it was a conversation with a fellow called Alan Jones. No, not that Alan Jones. Not him. But the former dean of Grace Cathedral in San Francisco. Rachael probably knows him from her interviews. We were both invited to speak at the Thomas Merton Institute in 2008 in Kentucky, in a place that the Americans call Louisville. Louisville. And Alan Jones told me that people often asked him, as the dean of Grace Cathedral, they used to say to him, "You're an educated man, Alan. How can you believe in these miracles and wonders?" And his reply to them was, and I quote, "It's a metaphor, stupid." And this was told to me at the Thomas Merton Institute in 2008. And Bernie still likes that, don't you, Bernie? Indeed he does, as a title. I wanted to use this as the book's title, but my American publisher, not by August Australian publisher, did not appreciate the joke. And they said, most Americans will be utterly offended by that title. They won't even pick it up if it says it's a metaphor, stupid. You're being offensive to them. But I said back in a following email, now hang on a minute. I don't know how old you are, but I'm in my 60s. Bill Clinton won an American election with the slogan, "It's the economy, stupid." Well, if he could win a presidential election on that, can't I write a book saying it's a metaphor, stupid? Apparently not. So anyway, that title has gone to heaven. And I'd like to thank Bernie Neville, who's standing there in Melbourne, who very carefully read the book. He's been a great teacher and mentor for me for decades. Anne Boyd and Matthew Del Navo in Sydney for reading the book and offering endorsements. And my dear friend and colleague John Dooley in Ottawa, Professor of Religion, for reading the manuscript and offering covers. Bishop Spong is in the, as we speak, writing an endorsement for this book. But I kept saying, hurry up, the book's about to come out. And he said, no, I'm doing another book of my own and I can't focus on anyone else's, but I'll give it to you by the end of May. So if this book does well, maybe it'll get into the second edition. I don't know. I'd like to thank my partner who's sitting on the floor, Lisa Jacobson, for her interest in this project and her encouragement when the way was tough, which it often was, actually. I'd also like to thank my daughter, Anna, and stepdaughter, Hayley, who's standing there with the red hair, for tolerating endless dinner table conversations about why religion should be read as metaphor and hoping not to destroy their faith in the process. And I'd like to thank my former students, some of whom I can see here tonight. I've resigned, actually, at La Trobe University and now a free man, as Joseph Furphy would say, unemployed at last. And now I can really, you know, I've quit my job, Rachael, so I can get back to work. This is really very important, to get back to work. And my students have been very helpful and receptive. I'd like to thank Rachael Kohn for her wonderful speech. Very challenging, bit edgy, and and I'll take that up live on radio. And thank readings, of course. Lisa, is it? Thank you for offering the space, which has been wonderful. I can't see too many chairs though, but anyway, it's been nice. And Garratt Publishing for arranging the launch. And I'd like to thank you all for coming. Thanks very much.